Good morning to all of you. I'm happy to be here amongst you today, and I would like to thank Birla Institute of Management Director, Deputy Director, and Professor Ramani for inviting me. To start with, I would like to introduce the panel members. You have an eminent panel today from various sectors. It's not just one sector, all the sectors which matter. So I will introduce one by one. Mr. Avish Bhatia, he is from HDFC Bank. As you are all aware, this bank has the highest market capitalization in India today. And the bank is doing extremely well because they have a simple strategy that you stick to your systems and procedures without any deviation. So that is the basic strategy HDFC Bank follows. That has paid them rich dividends. So they don't deviate from any of their systems and procedures. That is true across the group. So he comes from that. He is presently Executive Vice President and Co-Head of Corporate Banking. He is a seasoned banker with over two decades of experience. He has worked with banks like DCB, ABN AMRO, BNP Paribas in the leadership positions. He is from IIM Ahmedabad. He is an authority in credit appraisal and corporate banking. And Mr. Sankumar Verma, when you talk about Make in India, I attended at least 15-20 programs this year. So whenever I go for such programs, I find a person who comes and speaks on Make in India. So Schneider Electric is a very, very active player in this Make in India campaign. He comes from this company. He is currently working as Country Director, Customs and Taxation with the Schneider Electric Group. Prior to Schneider Electric Group, he was in leadership positions in companies like Nirma, Bayer and Coca-Cola. He is a seasoned professional with over two decades of experience in accounting, finance, taxation, and he has thorough understanding of business levers that are pivotal to the functioning of the organizations. Mr. Madhavan Hariharan, so whenever we talk about electronics, of course not today, over 10 years back, anything to do with, we never used to call a radio, we used to call it Philips. So Philips was synonymous with all electronics. So it was the global leader, and he's coming from that company. I was very happy to know that today they are 25% of sales is done through e-commerce. So currently the CFO of Indian subcontinent of Philips India, he covers a few other countries. And before this he was in China, Netherlands. He has worked with several Indian corporates like Tata Group, Ashok Leyland and PepsiCo. He is a chartered accountant company secretary with over 25 years experience. And he has experience in treasury, project management and financial control. Mr. Ajit Jha, he has about 28 years of experience. He has worked for all the leading companies. Those days, if you talked about the best corporate governance in India, there was Tata Steel. I believe he has worked with their chairman at that time. Tata Steel, Godfrey Philips India, Digo, Coca-Cola and Saab Miller. Apart from his corporate sector role, I also believe that he was closely involved with policy making in the government. He has developed the industrial plan for Bihar. He has worked with the World Bank, then ILO, so some of the leading institutions. And lastly, he was with Saab Miller as a director of regulation, looking after external affairs, communication, advocacy, government relations, legal regulatory affairs, and sustainability and corporate responsibility. Mr. J.K. Jain comes from one of the very well-known old groups in India, that is DCM. This is the first company in India to have a management leadership program. So their management leadership program was very well known in those days. It is like, if you talk about India multinational, it was Unilever. If you talked about an Indian company, that was DCM. So he comes from the group. He has about 24 years of experience. And he is a CFO of the group. He is responsible for finance, treasury, accounts, performance, management, taxation. And he is an MBA from IIM Ahmedabad. So we have all the eminent panel members with us. To start with, I will make a small presentation on this concept. Then we will take forward the panel discussion. The earlier presentation was a very good presentation because before you talk about the Make in India, well, in fact, since on this occasion I happened to read, since I committed to this, I went through some 10 reports on Make in India plus Indian versus Chinese manufacturing and Indian versus German manufacturing. Some of the leading universities, they published these papers. So this is some summary. Of course, I gained a lot of insights more than what I was knowing earlier. This is an initiative which was brought by Government of India in September 2014. And of course, even before this 2012, Indian government created a manufacturing council where they set an objective to increase the industry's GDP from 15%, not industry, manufacturing GDP, from 15% to 25% of Indian GDP. That was their, you must be wondering, the earlier presentation made, they talked about gross value added. That is a new concept which was brought by our present chief economic advisor. That is different from GDP. That is why you found that agriculture was contributing 18% to the slide. They identified 23 sectors for growth. The agency which is responsible for making this happen is DIPP, that is Department of Industrial Policy and Promotion. Mr. Amitabh Kant is the one who is driving this. And as it was mentioned in the earlier presentation, one of the important things, India was not accepted as a country about 15 years back in the world. The first brand India as a concept evolved after our presence in IT. So because of the IT prowess which India was able to go and achieve, the whole world started looking up India. As you are all aware, in the last 2 years, most of the tech companies in US, they appointed Indians as CEOs. So they chose. And similarly, if you go to NASA or any of the leading companies which are focused on science or R&D in US, you will find most of them are Indians. So that has been recognized. So India as a brand got established after our IT emerged as a major force in India. So now, on the similar lines, Make in India, we already created a big buzz. You will not believe, in the last year alone, I live in Mumbai, there are about 60 industry country delegations which came to Mumbai. Whenever such delegations come, I meet them. In fact, I chaired one panel when Singapore Business Federation, Singapore Manufacturing Association, they signed a MOU with Maharashtra government to set up manufacturing units in Maharashtra. This happened last month. Yesterday I was not there. Yesterday there was a big delegation which has come from China with some of the leading players. They want to set up manufacturing units in India. Already it is happening. As you all must have read, 3 or 4 mobile phone manufacturing companies in China, they committed to $4-5 billion of investment. So global publicity, already it has happened. Now Make in India means every country in the world, when they come, they talk this language only. They say, you have created a Make in India campaign, how can we participate? So we have created the bus, the publicity has happened. Now what has happened is that things on the ground. Then good encouragement for private sector and foreign companies to participate. As you are all aware, recently government relaxed FDA regulations further. And also the secretary mentioned, we want more than 90% of sectors in India to be open for FDI. Today they are not open. And they even opened up defense sector. Railways 100% is allowed today. So that is happening. Then widely accepted concept today, then this will create a lot of employment opportunities. Of course, when this program was created, the objective was that we have to grow our manufacturing growth every year by 15% up to 2022. And we wanted to create an employment opportunity for 110 million people. But at the present pace at which we are going, people feel even if we achieve 12%, if we create 70 or 80 million employment opportunities, it will be good. What we are seeing today, there is a synchronized growth slowdown across the world, mainly developed countries. One good thing is that 2 days back there was a report about US economic growth, which was better than what they expected previously. In BRICS, if you talk about BRICS, except China and India, all others are not doing well at the present moment. Russia is not doing well because the oil price down. Brazil is not doing well. And South Africa is not doing well. So only India and China, they are doing well. And there is a decrease in trade growth. And one more thing is this unconventional monetary policy. What is happening is that you can borrow funds at 2%, 3% from US and Europe. And you can bring the money into India and invest in projects which will give you a return of 12-14%. And of course, you bear the foreign exchange risk. So that is what has happened was, since they all reduced the interest rates almost closer to zero, lot of money came in. But once they start raising the interest rates, some of the money which has come in will start going back. So that is one. Then falling commodity prices. As you are aware, more than 50-60 countries in the world, they depend on commodities. At least 20-25 countries in the world, they depend on oil. Then other countries depend on copper, aluminium, steel. All the prices have gone down. So all these countries are affected today. So this is a projection which was brought by Economic Intelligence Unit about 4 days back. This is a projection for up to 2020. If you see, US will grow at 2-2.5%. Japan will grow at only 1.5%. Euro area, still it is struggling. At the maximum, it will grow at 1.5%. Euro area, then China, they expect it will come down to 4.8, but I don't agree. I wrote a piece on why China will continue to grow about 4 years back. I have a block on Indian economy. And they continue to grow. I don't agree with the 5 and 4.8 figures. They will continue to grow at 7% for next 5 years. So their projection, I don't agree. Because so far they have not still addressed the domestic market. Once they start addressing the domestic market, a part of growth will come from there. Then Eastern Europe, 2%. Asia, Australia, excluding Japan, there is Asian countries like now South Korea is reviving its manufacturing. Your Myanmar is looking at manufacturing, Vietnam is looking at manufacturing. So all these countries will become new centers of manufacturing. So they are going to compete. Then Latin America, again, as I told you, they are not doing well. Next year outlook is very bad. Middle East, where the oil price down. Of course, I attended one program on Global Islamic Summit last month in Dubai, where they said that their economy today is $1.8 trillion. And they say by 2020, it will reach $3 trillion. So that is the objective. So they are not just focusing on finance alone, they are talking about fashion, they are talking about manufacturing, they are talking about everything. Yeah. So it is called Islamic economy, not Islamic finance. So they are also going to compete. Of course, these are the other trends. Inflation in India, immediate outlook according to me is it is going to go up. We have the 7th pay commission. Now, most of the people who pay taxes are employed in the corporate sector, IT companies and government. So, you will find that if 4 lakh crores is going to be given by government, it will have multiplier effect at least 4 lakh crores, 4 times. So, a lot of money will go back to government in the form of tax also. Income tax will go, excise duty will go. So, at least 35-40% will go back to government. The remaining 60 will be circulated. So that is going to increase the inflation rate in India. So in terms of trade, this is very important when you talk about Make in India campaign. When you say we are going to manufacture a lot, we will not be able to consume everything within India. So the focus has to be on trade. How we can go and market it outside. So that is why we look at the world trade. If you look at the world trade growth, actually they are projecting $16-17 revive. So it has come down from 6.8 in 2010-11 to 2.2 in 2015. And again, if you see OECD countries, they will grow. But non-OECD 2015, there is a negative growth. So, what we used to see 8-9% trade growth those years, Those years are gone. Now trade will grow at only 4-5%. So we have to consider when we talk about Make in India, these factors. Then what are the things whenever we talk about India versus China is that we should always look at these comparisons. One thing we have to recognize is that the form of Chinese government is different. It's totally autocratic and they can control every economic parameter within China. If they want to control inflation, they can control. If they want to control interest rate, they can control. If they want to control growth rate, they can control. It's all within their control. But India is not so. India is a conglomeration of many countries. I'm not saying states. Many countries. So we have to run India by consensus, not by autocratism. Yeah? Already we started seeing the signs yesterday. You saw that now ruling government is reaching out to opposition and telling that we will not be able to do ourselves. So India is by consensus. So that is why the Chinese story is totally different from India. So if you see average manufacturing labor cost, today India has got a great advantage. That is, our cost is $0.92 per hour. China is 3.52, but I was told, all the studies indicate, Chinese labor productivity is 6 times higher than us. So if you multiply 6 into 0.92, that is more than 5.45, which is higher than China. It is not just cost per hour alone. It is the productivity of the labor that is more important. And manufacturing as a percentage of GDP. If you see countries like Philippines, Korea, Malaysia and all, they are all at a very low level. Now they are all above 25%. So ours actually, it has come down. Employment in manufacturing, in India, because of our labor loss, one of the issues when you talk about in Make in India is that, why we have so many small industries? The reason is the labor loss. So people fragment, instead of running one company, they run 10 companies, 10 different places. So there is an economy of scale. That is not available to Indian companies. So, whether that the formal employment, of course there are a lot of informal people, labor force, India 487 million, it's only 9.4% in India, whereas in China it is 14.5. But in terms of labor force, we are number 2. So what are the advantages for India? One, you always take it for granted, whether GST comes or not. What GST is going to do is that, just it is going to reflect the GDP growth which we have today, which is not included in our statistics. If you are saying our GDP is 5%, actually it is 7%. There is a large informal sector in the economy, which is not counted in your GDP. So actually when we say 5%, our growth is 7%. So when they say GST will add 1.5, it is going to transfer the numbers which are not there in informal sector to formal sector. That is what is going to happen. So they have told all Japanese companies to double their sales in the next 5 years, whichever sector they are in. So now we are also interacting with the US agencies. We are telling them when Japan can do, why can't you do? Ford has not done, GM has not done. Yeah? Toyota is doing, Honda is doing, but why can't Ford and General Motors? So now they started focusing. So these are all some of the things. Increased investor interest. China wants to participate in the railways, railway development, real estate development. They already signed up with the Gujarat government and Maharashtra government. France is committed. So like that, there are 8 countries already committed to India now, under the Make in India initiative, where everybody is talking about $20 million or $20 billion, $35 billion. So this has happened in the last 6 months. So investor friendly approach by central and state governments. One of the states which is going to grow very fast is Andhra Pradesh. Yeah? You are the first one in India to run state like a company. So in fact, you were awarded the best CEO award by the Economic Times 1 year against all the industry. So you will find Andhra is going to grow fast. Hopefully, BYR will grow very fast now. So they will follow. So some of these, so what is happening today? All these states, they are very, very investor friendly. Last year itself, 12 states conducted their investor conferences, asking companies to come and invest. Then liberalization of FDA explained to you, low labor cost, but it has to go with the higher productivity. Large investment from Japan, now we expect from China, US and other countries. Limitations, it was very well articulated in the earlier presentation, is one of the key limitations. Ease of business doing rank, even though they say 142, going by the interest, I will rate India within 25, but that 142, I believe World Bank takes only 2 or 3 cities or 4 cities for their ranking. They don't take the entire India. So that methodology has got some limitations. So that methodology, we have to suggest a new methodology to them by which our rank will go above 25. Yeah. The large number of procedures, one thing which I hear from one of our government functionaries come and speak, they say we'll reduce 76 procedures to 25. So like that it is happening, started happening. Then the license required multiple levels of government. China, if you go and convince provincial governor, finished. You need not go and convince everybody. Here, you do at central level, state level, district level, panchayat level. Once you get the approval, then some social activist comes and your project goes for a toss. 4 levels and still you are not assured of the implementation. So that is the problem. The lack of global scale, as I told you, most of our companies are very small. High cost of resources, mainly interest, and availability of finance, which was very well articulated. And one of the major things today, now there is a, recently they signed up for Trans-Pacific Partnership. This is between 12 developed countries, including US, Japan, and Europe. They constitute 40% of world GDP. So when you talk about making India and exports, what is going to happen is that these Asian countries will be covered and they will have preference over India to supply to them. So that is going to be a hurdle for us. Then China's counter initiatives. When we announced Make in India, they announced Make in China. Same time, I think same day. Same day it was announced, I think so. So they will have to just sit quiet. And of course, I will not go into the details. There are a lot of studies on this logistics and all, how we perform. They indicate that we rank very poorly. Similarly, road transportation, you mentioned 2 or 3 parameters. So roads have to be improved, ports have to be improved. I was just reading that they want to double and triple the port capacity by 2020. So if you look at all transportation, we are lagging behind. Then what are the other initiatives by Indian government? Industrial corridors, which we talked about. I think it came in your presentation. Smart cities. Identified 100, initially they will do 20 or 12? 12. 12 cities will be taken up. Smart cities can be the existing ones plus new ones. New ones means from start you can plan well. Yeah. Then industrial clusters, whenever you talk about industrial growth, one of the most important things is developing industries around a cluster. If you see India, auto cluster is there in Chennai, Gurgaon, where is Pune. Pune and Gujarat is emerging as one. IT if you take, you have Bangalore, you have Hyderabad, you have Gurgaon, you have Chennai. So if you do a cluster development, what happens is that not only large companies grow, even small companies grow. So that ecosystem gets created. So the cluster approach, industrial clusters, I think India has got 150 clusters for development. Then Digital India is another initiative whereby communication. Yesterday I attended this smart manufacturing conference conducted by CA in Delhi. So one of the speakers, I think Mr. M.M. Singh of Maruti said, when I was coming from my office to here, half the time I was not able to access my phone. So phone was not available. So how do we do business if we can't communicate? So that was his, so Digital India is supposed to enable us to look at how to do that and skill development. They have done already strategy paper for 22 sectors. I think there was an annual report which was released by Mr. Ramadurai 2 or 3 days back in a newspaper. I saw one page where what they have done so far. So that is another initiative which will help to address the manufacturing needs. So these are, as of today, we already have competitiveness in these industries. If you talk about small car, in any part of the world, they want to come to India. You know, Maruti exports a lot of cars, Hyundai exports a lot of cars, Honda started exporting. So cars means India today. Chemicals, we have IT and ITS is well known, jewelry and diamonds. I think DBS employs some 70,000 people in Surat. Leather, pharma, of course, now looking at us, people are looking at how to develop their pharma companies in other parts of the world. Generics, research and development, there are 8,000 foreign companies registered in India, employing 200,000 people. R&D, where we have the skilled pool. Then textiles, one more engineering. After IT engineering, we do a lot of exports. So the already we have competitiveness, way forward, further liberalization, attract Indian diaspora, as we are all aware, lot of money is available, first of all with Indians within India. As you are aware, 30% of our GDP savings. If you are talking about $2 trillion of GDP, 30% is $600 billion available within India. Then you talk about abroad, there will be another $3 or $4 trillion from Indians, with Indians. They can be, then path-breaking partnerships with other countries like the one we have with Japan, simplifying the procedure, focus on infra and logistics. Innovation is the other parameter. Of course, 10 years back, if you looked at any Indian company, hardly they spent, even a pharma company was spending less than 1% on R&D. Today, you look at Indian pharma companies, they spend anywhere close to 8 to 12%. But as India, we are spending less than 1% compared to 1.8 in China, 2.5 in US, 2.8 in... So, there we are lagging. Center-state relation is very important. And government-private sector, this is also very important. With this, I think it should be possible to move ahead in this direction. With that, I will... complete, then we will start the panel discussion.